Bipolar disorder is so complicated phenomenologically and diagnostically. And then to add more complexity, the treatments are very different. I don't just mean safety and tolerability, but on the efficacy profile. And I remember when I started, patients with bipolar would go on a mood stabilizer. The words mood stabilizer means nothing anymore. It used to mean lithium and valproate and carbamazepine, but that's not what it even means anymore. So we kind of get rid of that language. And now we talk about the different treatments and what effects they have across the different phases of the illness. So what I'll do, just focus on bipolar depression. That's the enemy of the state. That's the most common presentation. That's the most common presentation in clinics. We have very few options. And when you start to filter the medicines as a function of weight gain liability and diabetes, we have even fewer. So for example, we have cariprazine, lorazodone, and lumateperone, because quetiapine, olanzapine, fluoxetine, these agents have significant weight gain and metabolic disruption. I want to highlight lamotrigine. Lamotrigine is not FDA approved for bipolar depression, but it's not uncommon to adjunctively administer it in people who have bipolar depression acutely. Antidepressants, not recommended, or not FDA approved, I'm sorry, not FDA approved, but we're going to see very quickly here that they are very often prescribed. So in bipolar disorder, the modal number of medications people are prescribed is between 3 and 6. So polypharmacy is the rule, not the exception in this population, albeit polypharmacy is much more common later in the illness course than earlier. It makes us wonder whether if we can get them diagnosed and treated in a way that's more appropriate, that might decrease the likelihood of having such complex polypharmacy regimens. One of the questions I'm looking at right now in an analysis is whether or not some of the newer atypical antipsychotics approved in bipolar depression, because they have a broader spectrum of effect, can that decrease the need for so much medications being co-prescribed? I don't think anyone would take offense to reducing the number of medications. Lorazodone shown to be effective in bipolar depression. This has been with us now for the better part of a decade, monotherapy and adjunct. Because of the medication's engagement of certain receptors like the 5-HT7, like Trintellix, 4-deoxetine, there's been this lingering hypothesis, can this medication improve cognition? And that's one that we're still cogitating. We still don't know yet if that's indeed the case, but we have a reason to believe it could be. Some recent data showing that lorazodone could improve anhedonia in people with bipolar depression, which again, as I said, is a very common and very debilitating part of depression. And it's been shown to treat those 4 A's. In other words, the mixed features presentation, both in the bipolar population and in people with MDD. That is, people with major depressive disorder who don't have bipolar disorder, about 25% of them have mixed features. Lorazodone's been shown to be effective in treating that not uncommon presentation of major depressive disorder. Now, recently we've had cariprazine, since about 2018, was approved in bipolar disorder. And this is an agent that's approved in mania, mixed, and depression. So you have lorazodone in bipolar depression type 1, cariprazine's approved in mania, mixed, and bipolar depression type 1. And this is a drug that really preferentially engages the D3 receptor very quickly. The D3 receptor is located in the cognition control in the reward center of the brain. That gives you a little hint as to what it might be doing, and there are evidence to show that animals who take cariprazine are less anhedonic, they're a little smarter, and when you, in fact, run these analyses, what you're finding now in people with schizophrenia and bipolar disorder, there are some hints of improvement now in their cognition. I'd love to see a study with cariprazine in bipolar disorder with comorbid alcohol and drug abuse, given the role of D3 in modulating alcohol and drug misuse. There are some data to show that D3 modulation could reduce that, and we look forward to seeing if that study is done. This is data in bipolar depression type 1 with and without mixed features. And cariprazine, perhaps because of that effect on D3, is alleviating not just anhedonia, but also improving some of these cognitive elements that we think are so critical to mixed. In these patients who present with such hostility and agitation and irritability are exhibiting an improvement. And this is also seen in some of the hostility outcomes in schizophrenia where this medication is also been approved. Now, the FDA currently is reviewing cariprazine for potential augmentation of its label to now include major depression. The data have been submitted. We have data also in major depressive disorder, just like aripiprazole, brexpiprazole, wherein cariprazine has now been shown to be antidepressant when added to conventional antidepressants.